All right. Yes, sir. Thank you. Yes, sir. Yes, I feel your jealousy. I sense it. Peons, I dressed correctly. I apologize for this outfit. I thought it was a seminar tonight. Halfway here, my wife goes, "You should have worn that for the seminar night." I said, "Wasn't this a seminar night?" All right, so I'm a little ahead of my game. So I'll have to figure up a different outfit for next week. But I will be signing autographs on this outfit tonight. Yes. Okay, here we go. Seminars next weekend. I knew that. I just tested you. And somebody was here from, did you meet that guy?
Yes.
The radio shows, as you know, are on every day, Monday through Friday, in the morning and afternoon. And if you can't catch them, you can catch them on the internet. If you'd like to help out the ministry, we would appreciate it. You can switch over from Google to Good Search. And every time you use that thing, they'll donate money to us. Just put in our charity, Hardcore Christianity, and then that's all you have to do. It doesn't cost you a nickel. And all the radio shows are always available 24/7 on soundcloud.com/hardcore-christianity. Okay? Streamers, you ready to go? Thank you for your donations. Once again, everything's paid. God bless you. Thank you for your help. And I will be on TBN. I guess they've had some major shakeups at TBN.
Yes, they have.
You know, and Jan died. And the son took over Matt. And so he's revamping the whole system. So supposedly they canceled TBN here. Or they're going to cancel it or something. But anyway, they kept Joy in our town. So I'm going to, fortunately, the ministry down there, they like me. And so I'm going to get a chance to be on there, you know, fairly regularly. Not on a regular basis, but a fairly regular basis. So I'll be on Channel 21 and Joy in our town in about a week or so, Saturday and Tuesday, on their show. They've cut way back on, they've closed other TBN stations. They've sold a bunch of them off of Daystar. I think the Minnesota went sold, South Dakota sold, or something like that. Anyway, I don't really keep up with it. But anyway, there's a lot of shakeups going on with it at TBN. And apparently, this one here, by the way, this TBN here in Phoenix was the second one they ever opened. First one was in Costa Mesa, and the next one was right here. This is the second one they ever had. So they've trimmed that down significantly. So everybody's wondering about their careers and their jobs and all that stuff, that kind of thing, when you go through layoffs. Okay, I'll be out on Skid Row again on November 5th. I would appreciate your prayers for that. I'll be in L.A. that Saturday, ministering in a couple services. Okay, let's get going. I'll tell you what, the devil's taking over the planet. Finish this thing out. If you're a born-again Christian, you better develop some skills. And this is one of them you better start developing. This American Christianity crap does not work in the near future. You're going to have some real faith. Things are going to get really bad. And they're going to chop Jesus right out of everything. And they're doing it left and right. I kind of try to keep up with that on the radio and go over those stories. Here's what you're going to have to get, some Holy Ghost courage, or you're going to be in some big trouble down the road. Hell's coming looking for you. How do you get it? Oh, I'm glad you asked. Thank you. All right. First, before we talk about what you absolutely have to have, let's talk about the polar opposite. What would that be? Cowardice is the polar opposite of courage. Matthew chapter 8. There arose a great tempest in the sea. Remember this story? Everybody knows this one. But there's some details about it you may not have known. It's interesting ones. Seismos in Greek is not what is that? Yeah, it's an earthquake. And if it's underwater, it's called a... that there was a tsunami in the sea, and the ship was covered with waves, and Jesus was sleeping in the ship. And now that's a sound sleeper. That's a person that has a total rest and peace, and the devil has nothing in him. Because if you're sleeping and you're drowning at the same time, that's restful sleep. If I'm sleeping and suddenly there's a flood in the bedroom, I'm waking up. Not the Lord. He is scheduling this amount of time for sleep because I got this rally next tomorrow. I got these people need to be healed. I'm not waking up even though the ship is flooded. And here it was. It said the ship was covered with water, waves, and he's still asleep. The disciples had to wake him up while the place was flooded and said, Lord, save us, we're perishing. And he said, why are you delos? Now, this is not the Greek word for fear. It's the Greek word for cowardice. Fear and cowardice are kissing cousins. They're related. And they always go together. Fear demons and coward demons always work in tandem. The fear demon, phobos, where we get our English word phobia, is the one that gives you the initial panic. In counseling, we call it a panic attack. Yeah. How do you get panic attacks? You can get them on whatever triggers you. It may not trigger anybody else, but have a big fight with your spouse. Steal something, somebody rats on you. Are you with me? That surge of fear comes from a spirit, phobos, and it's the sudden shock that hits you. Delos, the cowardice spirit, is the one who gently makes you shy. Shyness comes from him. Shyness will keep you from getting help when you need it most. Shyness will make you too embarrassed to ask for help. Delos spirits, they will put shame on you to keep you down, buried, too afraid to get help. The fear spirit hits you hard, boom! Spirit causes you to not do anything about it. Jesus says to the disciples in the boat, why are you acting like cowards? Why are you acting like cowards? You were there yesterday when I fed 5,000. You were there 2 weeks ago. Lazarus came out of the grave. But the boat flooded and it turned you into a coward. Each person has a different coward trigger. What scares one person won't scare another. Mark chapter 4, check it out again. It happened again. The devil tried to kill him twice. There was a great storm. This is not a seismos, it's a lalips. What is that? A hurricane. There arose a hurricane of wind, Mark chapter 4, and beat into the ship, so that ship was full of water. And he was doing it again. He was in the stern. Brumna, asleep again, on a soggy pillow. Now that's hard to do. When I was up in Minnesota ministry, and they had a guy up there on TV all day long doing ads. My Pillow. You ever heard of him? He sells My Pillow. Apparently, these things are selling all over the planet Earth. Everybody, does anybody own a My Pillow? Nope. Used to. And what happened? Oh, well, the queen is fuzzy. My goodness. My, okay. Simsalabim. You don't like it. You don't like my pillow. Well, anyway, honey, you wouldn't like this one. This one was soaked. You would have filed a complaint with the guy in the stern. It says they awoke. They awoke him again. They said, Master, don't you care that we're perishing? See? Now here we have a peek into Satan's world. He draws the curtain back. And he shows us how the devil beats Christians. Wow, it's fantastic revelation. First he brings in the trauma. See? There it is. The divorce, the bankruptcy, the sickness, the illness, the layoff, whatever it is. He instigates that. He works behind the scenes to trap you. He works behind the scenes to get you to make bad choices, which contribute to the disaster. He's always there working somewhere in the shadows, outsmarting Christians. Demons are different than Christians. They think ahead. Christians just go day by day. They don't think ahead. They're reactive. Demons don't. They plan stuff out. So if you're going through a disaster, that was a planned disaster before you got there. When these disasters hit, the spirits switch gears. And they blame God for it. They did it, but they blame the Lord. American carnal Christians, which is like 99% of them, they will then blame God. And they will accuse him of all kinds of incredible things. We've all been there. It's happened to every Christian, man. Things get tough. Pray about it, nothing seems to change. Man, that's tough. Hurts. And then they whisper into you. Whisper, hey, it's God's fault. They nailed all 12 of the disciples on this one. He doesn't care. Don't you see it? Oh, that's his big key. Disaster strikes. And the devil wants you to reach this point. He doesn't care. Once you reach that point, you got to go through the whole thing. That's his goal. The Holy Ghost revealed it right here. The text isn't just splattered on the scrolls. This is divinely inspired. You face a disaster, the coward demon moves in. He whispers at you. He doesn't care. He doesn't care what you're going through. You've been praying, haven't you? Nothing changed, did it? That's the coward spirit. Very powerful. Very subtle. Very bright. Jesus arose and rebuked the wind. Now that's an interesting set of text as well. This word here was only used by Christ, epitomatum, when he was referencing Satan or demons.
That's correct.
He never used it any other way. What's it telling us? Oh, another divine revelation. Like Job chapter 1, the devil can control the weather. The insurance companies ignorantly call it an act of God. Stupid Christians actually call it judgment of God. But past their ignorance, you see God's word revealing the truth. The devil can control the weather. If you don't believe me, you look in Job chapter 1. It couldn't be any clearer. It can't be any clearer here. The devil was trying to drown him. Oops. He forgot about the Holy Ghost. The wind ceased, and there was a great calm. See? Once you face your disaster, the fear demon gives you the initial surge. And the coward demon whispers, he doesn't care. If you will hold on to the horns of that altar, there's a great calm right over there. Why are you, oops, same Greek word, why are you acting like cowards? Ever met an addict? Oh, watch these, watch them spirits, watch them. They're so clear. The addict faces some trauma. Housing, money, relative, kicked out. Something happens. Behind the scenes, the demons are orchestrating the triggers for the addicts.
Yes.
24/7.
Yep.
The trigger hits, and this fear surges through the addict. They're CNS for a good period of time, doing well. Support group, praying. But then the trauma hits. Then the fear demon shocks them and surges. Oh, God, what am I going to do? Then the coward demon. So, well, while you're trying to figure that out, why don't you relax? Is anybody listening to me?
Yes.
They come to you quietly. Man, this is too much. Why don't you relapse? You'll feel better. The coward demon, instead of fighting through it, instead of grabbing the horns of the altar, instead of trusting God, the coward demon drifts them away. The demons move back in. Had they held on just a little longer, there was a great calm right there. Oh, this is a great verse. Deep revelation here. Fear spirits suck the faith in God. The demons know things you don't. What's one of them? Faith and fear cannot coexist.
That is correct.
Faith and fear, F, cannot coexist. It's either that one or it's either that one. Cowards have. Had a girl come down the altar one time. I says, how come you're not telling me what you need? Just relax. Just talk to me. I don't know. She's whispering. I said, you got bad shyness, don't you? Yeah. When did you have that? I got it when I was a kid. What happened when you, oh, this and that happened. I said, that's a coward spirit. You got a coward spirit. There's no shyness. That's something humans make. Nobody heard me. There is no such thing as shyness. That's a load of crap. You pick that up in childhood. That's a person. When you got the Holy Ghost, you can't have. These are good scriptures, I'm telling you. You know they are. Shyness is not a personality trait. No, honey. That girl got healed that night. The demon of fear came out of her. Mark chapter 4. They feared exceedingly. Now, here's the initial shock. Phobeo. Panic. Panic sets in. My God, what kind of a person is this? They'd already seen all these incredible miracles. But they saw that and they got scared. People have different triggers for fear. Depending on how you're raised, who raised you, your environment, your life experiences. And the demons use those experiences to beat you down. Matthew 14. When the disciples saw Jesus walking on the sea, here's another sea incident, they were troubled. That's the Greek word tarasso. It means to be overly anxious. Now we're getting a deeper revelation of the psychiatry of the spirit world. Anxiety is their third partner. You get the shock of fear, but leading up to it, they roll the red carpet of anxiety out for you. You start to get a little nervous, see? You start to get your tics going. There you go. And you feel like you're in a scene from The Wizard of Oz. Lollipop Land. They get the Lollipop Land going. And then the trauma hits. Boom! The fear strikes. Then the coward demon. Ooh. We're not going there to The Wizard of Oz. We're going to stay here under our lily pad. You go that way, Dorothy. Fear, cowardice, anxiety work together to ruin your life.
Yes.
Demons think, Christians just react. Oh my God, it's not Jesus Christ, it's a phantasma, a water spirit, a phantom. Did you know that all patients that have psychoses all have fear spirits? Every patient I ever counsel over the years that had psychoses also had the psychotic patients, they're not these kind of patients. Oh, there's some clouds. There's some butterflies. There's flowers. Whee! No, 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 no. No, it's not that kind of vision at all. Ah. No, it's the other thing. It's some night stalker. It's a nightmare. It's a dream about somebody dying. It's always something negative. Why? The fear spirits are trotting for the strike. So you will obey the coward demon and not do anything about it. Like exercising your faith. Fear demons are so powerful, they will get you to see God as the devil. They're so powerful, they will get you to see Jesus Christ as Satan. He doesn't care about me. He's not listening. He doesn't know about the bankruptcy and the divorce and my car broke down. He's not around. Since he's not around, the coward spirit will whisper to you, you might as well just give up. They cried out. They start yelling. Have you ever had somebody spook you? Boo! Ah! That's a fear spirit. They're yelling. There. Fear. You see the polar opposite. The Son of God sleeping in the water on a wet pillow, snoring away. See the difference? One had the Holy Ghost. The other had fear spirits, anxiety spirits, coward demons. You see the polar opposite right in the boat. And you see the devil outside the boat causing the storm. Right away, the Lord tried to help him. What did he do there? He tried to pour on the disciples the acid killer of anxiety. Holy Ghost cheer. See, you can't be afraid when you've got Holy Ghost cheer. You're not afraid of anything. Hey, don't be panicked for Bell. Chill out. It's me, not the devil. When you're afraid, your life is distorted and you don't see God. So you think you're seeing the devil. You think you see the devil when it's actually God. You can't see straight or think straight when you're being panicked. Panic causes you to temporarily lose your mind. Matthew 14, again, Peter said, Lord, if it's you, tell me to come out on the water here. And he said, it is me. I'm not a phantom. I'm not a demon. Calm down. Well, Peter had started to calm down. What happens when you calm down? What happens when you stand and fight fear and cowardice? Your faith returns. Peter said, wait a minute. I'm going to chill myself out here. That doesn't look like the devil. I think that is the Lord. Can I come out? Polar opposites, faith and fear. They never go together. Peter catches it and he goes, well, I'm not afraid anymore. I've got my faith back. He steps down out of the boat. The other 11 disciples, they didn't have it. They were shivering in the back. For some reason, Peter, the only one, broke from the pack and headed out on the water. I'm going to tell you something straight up. You're going to have to break out of your pack of your Mickey Mouse Christians, family, and church. You're going to have to go away from them and step out on your own. Peter did it. He left the other shiverers over there. He said, I've got my faith back now. I've lost my fear. I'm going to step out. And it worked. He's walking on the water. He's heading over to the Lord. Notice he's on his way to God when his faith returns. When you're relapsing, when you're collapsing, when you're falling apart, your faith is gone. Why? Anxiety has now brought in the fear spirit. The fear spirit left you with a coward spirit. Now you're looking for a house to fall on you. And you stop right there going to God. You stop right in your tracks. Peter's going to Jesus because he got rid of his fear. He got rid of his anxiety. Oh, who's going to see me? Oh, what are they going to think of me? He didn't care what the other church people thought of him. He didn't care what somebody else thought of him. Why? He had gotten rid of his coward spirit. A coward spirit will make you always wonder what somebody's thinking about you. See? I have a little of that myself. That's why I dress so well. I want a lot of positive feedback. And so what it is when you leave the other cowards behind and you step out, Father meets you there. And then he waits for them. While he's on his way to Jesus, full of life, all of a sudden he takes his eyes off the Lord. There it goes. What comes back? All of a sudden, he looks around and boom, panic hits him. He's not sinking yet. Oh, he didn't hear it. Fear many times will hit you before you start to sink. The fear spirit attacks your mind. He got into his head. Don't you see it? Demons don't need to swim. They're out on the boat, but they're not swimming. They're spirit beings. They transverse Ephesians 6 in the atmosphere. They got into Peter's head while he was walking on the water. and he wasn't even sinking. Fear will make you in this life your worst enemy. Well, now he starts to receive a panic situation, and once again, these spirits have incredible powers. They make you see stuff that's either not there or it's distorted. You think God's the devil. You think the devil's God. You see the wind. You see stuff you can't see. And that was before he started to sink. Fear will bring you a disaster before it ever hits. It's that holy shoot moment. And nothing's happened. Hey, you want to come over for Thanksgiving? Is Uncle Jack going to be there? The guy that picks his nose and scratches his crotch and farts at dinner. Yeah, we invited Brother Jack. He doesn't have any friends. No shoot, Sherlock. Fear causes you to fear before you ever get to Thanksgiving. You've got that anxiety coming in. I apologize if I, to the nth degree, describe some of your relatives. I apologize for that. Now, here it is. Panic set in before he sank. Then the sinking comes after fear. What comes after that? The normal routine. He starts yelling, "Hey!" That's a dead giveaway if somebody's scared. See? That's a YouTube moment. You can go on YouTube and there's 5 million videos of people getting, and they're all yelling, "Ah, good God." So he does the same thing. He yells, "Ah, Lord, save me." Had this not happened, this would have never needed to happen. Why? If you could have just hold on to God's word, the horns, a little bit longer, there was a great calm right over there. When the disciples heard the voice, they fell on their faces. Matthew 17, the transfiguration. Jesus is shining like the sun. He's back home in glory. And Father speaks to them. They didn't collapse in fear when Moses was there yakking. They didn't collapse in fear when Elijah was there yakking. They saw them there. They saw Jesus there. So far, no problem. See? People who don't have any faith fear what they cannot see. Carnal, lukewarm Christians want everything laid out right in front of them, and they want to see every little thing and all the details. Can I see all the details and what's required? Then I'll make a decision whether I want to have any faith or not. Oops, that's not the definition of faith. Who explained Christianity to you? Huh? The Jehovah's Witnesses? No, that's not how Christianity works. Oops. I guess I got my terms mixed up. You got your whole faith in Christ mixed up. That's what you got. Faith is believing things you cannot see. They couldn't see somebody talking to them. It was Father. He said, "Hey, this is my son, the beloved. This is the most important person in the universe. He's going to save your souls from an eternity in hell. There he is. Listen to what he's saying. He speaks for me." What had happened to them? Oh, they panicked. Oh, bam, they were panicking. The surge of fear struck them. And then Jesus came over to them to touch them. Have you ever done that? Sure you have. Everybody has. Or 99% of everybody has. Somebody's scared or afraid, and you... Hey, come here, sweetie. Oh, honey. Your kids. Anybody had kids? Every parent has done it, I think. Or 99% of them. What happened? I don't know. Come here. Come here. Jesus goes to get the disciples like babies. Goes up to get them. Don't panic. God spends half the Bible begging you. Don't panic. I got this thing under control. The Holy Ghost has got this thing in the bag. Chill yourself out. Don't panic. I've got it. If you won't panic, just right over the hill, there's a deep calm. Do that. When they lifted up their eyes, they saw only Jesus. Matthew 25. Then he which received the one talent came to his Lord, and he said, Lord, I know you're a hard man, and you're a tough businessman. You make money when you don't even do anything, this and that and that and this. He goes on and on describing him. He says, but I panicked. I don't know, 100 times over the years in a counseling session, when somebody says to me, you know what I should have done? I should have married that person. I should have taken that job. I should have moved there. I should, you know what stopped them in almost every case? See, carnal, lukewarm American Christians like things in order. And they like it just put right there. And they like it laid out on a silver platter. The delusion Christians live in is that life doesn't really exist. It's just all about them. Life don't line up in an order and come to you on a silver platter. I panicked, so I hid your talent. I didn't do anything with it. Mark chapter 5, they came to Jesus seeing the man who was possessed by the demons. This is the maniac of Gadara. This guy had a legion of spirits in him. I don't think we've ever had anybody here that had that many demons. We've had a few that acted like it. But anyway, this guy, this was a severe case, severe mental illness case. We call them SMIs here in Arizona. Anyway, the townspeople came out and they saw him sitting there clothed in his right mind and they panicked. They panicked. They saw something they had not seen before. See, carnal lukewarm Christians like everything lined up like a train set. Stop. That's fun. Mega church Christians got yellow streaks down their backs. Why? Because life ain't like that. Life don't go like that. Trust me on that one. Just take it. As soon as people see something they've never seen before, the first instant of a human being is when the fear demon strikes. Back off! Fear spirits will get you to do things that are horrible. Do you know what they get you to do? They will tell you to isolate yourself from God. Because you're afraid he's looking at you negatively, critically. So you naturally step back. Human beings by nature will step away from people they don't trust. People you don't trust cause you what? Anxiety. don't you overcome that and just go apologize or talk it out? The coward demon comes along and says, wait a minute, no. You're too shy for that. What if he has a fit? Don't you see how they work? If only Christians knew that Christianity actually is a gigantic psychiatry experiment. We are Pavlov's dog. And the Holy Ghost and the devil are trying. We can't see them. So we're the ignorant ones. Because we don't believe God's word. When you get afraid and you make a mistake or something goes wrong, you have a natural reaction to do exactly what the devil told you to do. Back away from Father. And the Holy Ghost is trying to get you to do the opposite. When you're in your worst spot, run to Him. Because there's a great calm just over there. They asked Him to leave. I don't understand that. That spooks me. I don't want to investigate that. I'm just going to run back to my pig farm. If you don't get rid of that fear and that cowardice in your spirit, man, you know what you're going to end up doing? Dying in a pig farm. A pig Christian. You're going to die a pig Christian. No rewards in heaven. No victories. No pattern of overcoming and living God-centered Christian life. You're going to end up with the pigs like those Samaritans. They ran back to their pigs. Why? Because they were afraid. I never saw that before. Let me give you a little bit of advice here. I don't usually do that. Just because you run into something you don't know about doesn't mean it's wrong. You know why? You don't know everything. Ooh. Oh, I just heard everybody. Everybody just pull out the swords now. Listen, human beings don't know everything. You will always run into something you don't understand. Chill yourself out! Because there's a great calm just right over the hillside. Lord, get the heck out of here! Because I'm afraid and I'm confused. The Holy Ghost is saying, hey, you come in when you're like that. Do not run from me. Here's what demons really do.
But what if she kills this fight?
I said no!
There's your typical born-again Christian. Facing tribulation and a trial, not understanding everything, not seeing everything, panicking. And coward demon says, run like hell!
Do not arouse the wrath of the great and powerful Oz. I said, come back tomorrow.
If you are really great and powerful, you keep your promises.
Do you presume to criticize the great Oz? You ungrateful creatures! Think yourselves lucky that I'm giving you audience tomorrow instead of 20 years from now. Oh, the great Oz has spoken. Oh, pay no attention to that man behind the curtain. The great Oz has spoken.
Who are you?
Oh, I am the great and powerful Wizard of Oz.
You are? I don't believe you.
No, I'm afraid it's true. There's no other wizard except me.
You humbug!
Yes, it's exactly so. I'm a humbug.
Oh, you're a very bad man.
Yeah. Don't you see this divinely inspired movie?
Oh, yeah.
God is trying to tell you, he's telling the Samaritans, he's telling Peter, he's telling the disciples in the boat, listen, fear demons, coward demons, and anxiety have zero power over you. They only have power over you when you let them have it. You gave it to them. They're bluffing. There was no Wizard of Oz. It was a guy, old man with hemorrhoids. Be of good cheer. What's he trying to tell you? There's no Wizard of Oz. The devil's bluffing you. He's bluffing you with this temptation. These goofy relatives, these kooks at work, they're bluffing you. They're trying to get you to spook and panic and be afraid. Then the coward demon will try to get you to isolate yourself and withdraw yourself from God so you don't get any help. The only person that had any anointing there was the dog. Pulled the curtain off the devil. That's what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to pull the curtain back for you. He's bluffing. He's lying. He's trying to intimidate you with nothing. He knows he has nothing until you give it to him. The devil only has what you give him. God did not give us cowardice. There it is. You get power, supernatural power from the Holy Ghost. You get unconditional love from God. You get a sound mind from God. How come you don't have a sound mind? Because you took in a coward spirit. You're too shy. Well, I don't know how to fight back. I can't fight anything. What? Somebody's bluffing you. Somebody's bluffing you. He's bluffing you. He makes you afraid because you listen to him. You're listening. Revelation chapter 21 shows you the end of people who are cowards. What's the end for them? Let's see. Cowards. Unbelievers. Abominable people. Murderers, liars, all liars. Do you watch any of the debates?
Oh, yeah.
All these politicians, all of them, didn't say some of them, have their part. That's where cowards go. They end up, in the end, with absolutely nothing.
All right, that's right. Here we go. King gets a 3. Queen, deuce. 7. Pair of Savannahs right here. Deuce gets a 4. No help. And the 3 gets big ace. Bet the Savannahs.
Cuter.
Oh. I call.
Kick a buck.
$1?
What? One time.
All right, I'll call. Yeah, if I catch them, I'll burn you. I'll call.
King 3, you got a 4. Queen deuce gets a 5, and a pair of 7s gets a John, and the big ace gets slapped in the face. Okay, you still do the talking.
Cuter again.
I call.
Shot at me.
What you got?
Pass that.
I can see that motherhead. What you got in the hole? He ain't got nothing. Show him, raise his head off.
Been bent his head since ago.
All right, then you just call him.
Call.
You gotta see a gambler.
You got it.
I can't catch. I'm sick there. I can't catch. I'm going. King 4-3, you got a 9. Nothing visible. Pair of 7s and a jack gets a 6. Savannah, is you still a better man?
Cuter.
I'm beat, Dan.
Kick it back a buck. Kick it back
a buck.
Kick a buck.
Damn.
Don't look at me, mother.
Well, come on. What you gonna do? Play like a coconut? You got to
call him anyway. I know he's got a pair of kings. Then I have to stuff up my nose.
Well, you still gotta call him anyway.
But you gotta.
You gotta look at him.
The man's got kings. Get your tail out.
Yeah.
You want to see him?
Yeah.
Right there. 1, 2, yeah. 3, 4, 5.
Yeah. Oh. Mic'd up, right?
He beat you at nothing. Just like today when he kept coming back at me with nothing.
Yeah, well. Sometimes nothing can be a real cool hand.
We'll sit in here next to my boy. Here, Duke.
Deal. It can't be any clearer what the devil's doing to you. Don't you see it? He's bluffing. He knows he's got nothing. Except when you fold, you lose. What do we need instead of a bunch of fear and anxiety and cowardice that typical Christians have? Well, we need something else here. Deuteronomy 31. Be strong and of good courage. Why? Because Jehovah, a divine psychiatrist, understands fear causes you to fold. So he's got to fix it. How does he do that? I am going with you. I will not fail you. I will not forsake you. This is Moses' final instruction to the people of Israel. Why? Because he knew the Jews were a bunch of cowards. They collapsed at a drop of a hat. They would fold their hand on a pair of twos. The first thing he said, be strong and of good courage. You go with this people into the land, Joshua. Listen, you must be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Oh, fear is the faith killer. When faith goes down, you fold your hand. There goes your Jehovah promised to give this land to their fathers. He's a, quote, man of his word. You will cause them to inherit this land. Jehovah is going where? Running way behind? No. Oh, man. Before the devil ever deals you a crappy hand, the Holy Ghost already fixed it. He will what? I will not fail you. That's why people don't trust anybody. You know why? They look at their track record. People have seen your track record. Yeah, I didn't see a crowd come in with you. You know why? Because they've seen your failures in the past. See? You've trained people not to trust you. Oh. When you said you'd do that and you didn't do it, you were training that person not to trust you. Father has none of those qualities. That's never happened to him. So Moses is giving Joshua everything he has here. He will not fail you. Why? Because he is unable to fail you. It's not just that he chose not to let you down. He's not able to let you down. He doesn't know how. I thought God knew everything. There's all kinds of stuff he doesn't know. This is one of them. Letting you down is, in fact, in truth, an impossibility. He will not forsake you. Like your friends, your relatives, your spouse, your kids, they all bolted out the door. I get that. I've been there. Father never bolts out the door. If you're having a problem with Father, it's because you left. Do not fear them. Why? Fear is the Christian killer. It slaughters people's faith. It causes them to go back to their old lives. Why? Why would somebody go back to something old and bad? Why would they go back to an old relationship that stinks? Why would they go back to drugs and alcohol when things were bad? Why? Why? Why do people do that? Why do people do that? Because human beings, by nature, like something they're comfortable with and know about. What they see in the future and don't know really bothers them. So they will go back to a beating husband. There she goes. I told her not to go. You told her not to go. Don't go back to him. Let's see, what am I going to do in my future? I kind of know what that is. Uncomfortable. Back. Fear will cause you to go back to something crappy. And you will endure suffering. Oh, that one should have got in. People will endure suffering in their life when fear has stalked them down. Why? People like something they're comfortable with over the unknown. There it is. He mentions it again. Fear. Then he gives us an incredible level of insight. What does fear really cause? Confusion. I don't know where to go. I don't know what to do. That's why they cry out. Ah! They don't know what to do. They are dismayed. Joshua chapter 1. After the death of Moses, what happened? Jehovah spoke to Joshua. Moses is gone now. Okay. Now he's on Joshua. See? Your relatives, your minister, they're gone now. Now he's on you. And he says to him, Moses, my servant's dead. Go. You go. I'll give all this land to Israel. Joshua chapter 1. From the wilderness here to there to Lebanon to the river Euphrates, you name it, anywhere you look at it, it's all yours. For all the promises of God in Christ are yea and amen. What keeps you from taking those promises and using them? Now I know you're going to get scared. Jehovah said. So let me try to preempt that. What is the Bible trying to do for you? Preempt your fear. Every verse, practically. Trust in the Lord with all thy heart, and lean not to thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy path. Translation, don't be afraid. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. I go to prepare a place for you. If I go there to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself. There you may be with me all three. Translation, don't be afraid. I got it covered. I got this thing covered. The Holy Ghost has got this thing covered. I'll just preempt it, Jehovah says. I got to take a preemptive strike here with Joshua to make sure that the worst thing that can happen doesn't happen. What is that? Fear. Look, no man will ever stand before you all the days of your life. If you, as a born-again Christian, could just grasp that concept, your whole life would change almost immediately. If you had any idea that the Holy Ghost has got every person analyzed from pillar to post before you ever meet them, he knows all about their strengths and weaknesses. He's on that person, that job, that thing, that doesn't matter. I got it all covered for you. You don't have to be afraid of them. What do people fear most? Usually other people. Starts in grade school. Johnny, get up and share your project. Oh, God. Oh, jeez. The fear strikes the kid in grade school. Then it transfers the rest of their lives. You think I'm making that up? Far from it. Grade school fears stay with the person till they die. Fear of people. Fear of being criticized. Fear of being analyzed. What do I look? What do I smell like? What am I saying? Why do you think women spend 6 hours in the bathroom? Why? Why? Because they're intergalactic beauties? No. It's third grade. It's second grade. Look at your shoes. We don't like your shoes. So those kids don't like your shoes. Oh, God. Grade school fears can haunt a human being till their grave. Don't be afraid of them, Jehovah said. Have no fear of them. I got that covered. As I was with Moses. You saw what I did with Moses. I am going to stay with you just the same way. I will not forsake you. I will not fail you. Be strong and very courageous. All you have to do is observe and do God's holy word. I hope this is helping the streamers. Turn not from my word to this side or that side. Stay right there. Focus, translation. Focus on what I told you. Don't be afraid of them. Everywhere you go, I've got it covered. Cowardice and fear don't need to haunt you, not for one more day. Everywhere you go, it says, anywhere you go, my word will go with you. I'm down here Tuesday and Fridays every week practically. All I'm doing is sharing God's word. Why? Because nothing I have is worth a tinker's hoot. Who gives a flying fart what I think? I don't have any skills or ability. I can't heal anybody. I'm looking to Jesus, the author and finisher of my faith. I'm looking here. Hey! Because if I look out there, I'm going to get scared. You know when you're the most scared? I'll answer it for you. When you got to rely on you. You'll fill your pants like a 2-month-old baby if you sense or feel all you've got to back yourself up is you. God Almighty! You think that's in hell? It's pure hell! Is this too blunt for this crowd? Maybe it's too much. Follow God's holy word. It's all written right there. Fear not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. Don't be afraid of them. You do what I tell you, Jehovah said, then there's a deep calm just over the hillside. And there's a song about it. Have I not told you? Be strong and of good courage. Why does he keep repeating this? Because he's trying to circumvent the Satan's fear he would bring upon the Jews and Joshua. He knew Goliath was out there and the giants and all these sinners and these idolaters and these murderers, these killers, these rapists, these monsters. He knew the demons were running amok in those countries. He was trying to circumvent them being afraid. How do I know that? Be not afraid. Because I can read. Fear brings what? Confusion.
Yes.
Don't you see it? Fear causes you to doubt God, misinterpret God, misinterpret scriptures, run to people you shouldn't be running to, getting advice from imbeciles, talking to nincompoops. Pretty soon you're so jacked up, you haven't got a ghost of a chance of hell getting out of anything. Why? You panicked. And now you're dismayed. You don't need to be afraid. You don't need to be confused. I am with you. I'm with you. Don't be afraid of them. Joshua 10. It came to pass they brought the kings to Joshua. What happened? Joshua does what he's told. He goes out and he starts raiding these countries. He racks up five kings here, like Cool Hand Luke. Five. A hand of nothing. Joshua had a big hand of something. He lines up five of these pagan idolatry kings. He calls the men of Israel out. Come on out here. Come out here. I want you to watch this. What's he doing there? He's trying to keep their courage up. He's trying to give them courage to keep going, okay? Which is what we all need. Nobody has everything every day, every minute, every month, every year. I got to have some help. I'm a person. I need help. Father knows I need help. So he sends a little bit of this encouragement, a little bit of that along for me, keeping me going. Keep going, Mike. Come on, boy. Don't sit down and poop your pants. Get up here. Be strong and of good courage. Be very courageous. Don't be afraid of them. Come on out here. I got five kings here. Check it out. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Come out. Come near. Put your feet on their necks. Throws them all on the ground. Put your feet on their necks. Come on. What's he doing there? Playing footsie? No, he's trying to get the people to disregard fear and be strong and courageous. Look, I'm victory. What did he do with them? Hung them. The Bible says he beat them up. Then he hung them. Why? He wanted them to be seen, don't you? Hanging demons, hanging the devil, gives everybody courage. When they see you winning, it bleeds over to somebody else. When they see you panicking, it bleeds over to somebody else. Joshua was trying to get the fear out of the camp. So he hung them for everybody to see. Jehovah said, this is your land. We're taking everything. Here's the down payment. Five kings. That's four kings and a joker. I like to tell jokes sometimes just for me. So tonight by 11:30, I'm laughing at in the car. And the wife is driving. She's not listening. She just looks at me. I'm laughing in the car. She's looking at me. I got to get him home and on his medication. Jesus, the Son of God, far greater than Moses and Joshua. A million of them couldn't compete with him. Said to you, what? Fear not. Fear not. That's the short version. You have authority. You can stomp on those kings' necks. Pateo, to stomp. Don't you see it? We don't stomp on people anymore. We stomp on the demons. We stomp on the devil. We stomp on sin. We stomp on doubt and fear and cowardice. Stomp on it. Nothing will hurt you. Don't be afraid of them. Fear not. Why? Fear brings confusion. Be strong and good courage. The Lord will do to all your enemies. American Christians don't understand how the spirit world works. When a Christian faces a trial or temptation, the trial and temptation is already beaten. But Father expects you to walk into it and get it. Which is going to require something, I know this is a hideous thing to say, effort on your part. God, get a knife, shoot him, kill him, lynch him. No, don't lynch me. I'm trying to help you. Every trial you face has already been beaten. But Father expects you to walk into it using faith. What is that? If you have faith, you are courageous. If you fear, you have none. And so you are confused. Correct. What do I do? How do I pray? Where do I go? What do I pay? Who do I visit? Who do I talk to? Confusion comes in. Why? Behind the confusion, you will always find fear, anxiety, and cowardice. He stomps them and hangs them on five trees. Joshua chapter 10, if you don't believe me, it's right there. 1 Chronicles 28. David said to King Solomon, his son was little then, right? In America, we vote for presidents that are like in their 60s and 70s, older than me. The two baboons we got running now are both older than me. I'm in my 60s, and they're like got 2 feet in the grave. And their brain, God only knows where their brains are. I have no idea. That's another Bible study. But Solomon was a little back then, see? Back Israel would elect a king who was sometimes a kid. Well, the first thing you've got to do with a kid is what? Practically, help them not be afraid. Afraid of what? Getting dressed, going to school, doing homework, speaking. There's all kinds of... Any parents here? You got a million different fears you got to help your child through as they grow. And that's your job as a parent to help them assist them and love them and encourage them. Why? Because if they get afraid or they develop fears, they will become unsuccessful people. They will become chronic failures. They will rely on you too much instead of growing and being strong and of good courage and not be afraid of them. They will develop fears without a good parent. So David said, listen, first thing I got to do with my son is what? Click. Circumvent his future fear because he will be confused if he gets afraid. People get afraid and they run down the hall and jump out windows. I just showed it to you. He says, now here's how you can overcome your fear. Jehovah will be with you. He will not fail. It's the same thing Moses said to Joshua. It's the same thing Joshua said to the leaders of Israel. It's the same thing God's saying to you tonight. He will not fail you until you have finished the call of God on your life. I don't have a call. You're a liar. You're a liar. Oh, y'all are lying. Every born-again Christian has some kind of call from Father. Never see it if you're afraid. Luke chapter 12. God's talking to you, and you know how he sees you? As a friend. Do not panic. Never panic over them. Why? The most they can do to you is what? That's it. But after they kill you, they can't do anything else. Jesus said, I'm warning you, whom you shall panic over. If you don't know Jehovah, you better start panicking. That's the problem with this planet. Nobody has any fear of God. Everybody just does anything they darn well please. Why? They have no fear of God. Jesus is trying to get people to understand. People who don't have any fear of God at all are fools, are lost. Carnal Christians don't have any fear of God. They've got greasy grace over at the megachurch, so they just live any way they want to. They sin over here and then they don't. It doesn't work that way. Those people have no fear of God. Therefore, they lose their anointing, they lose their call, they lose their blessings, they lose their answers to prayer because they have no deep reverence for Father. This is a person people should have fear of. Because after you're dead, Gehenna, the lake of fire. Jesus said, I'm telling you, this is the person you should fear, not those people. Fear not them, which can kill the body, but are not able to touch your soul. People should fear the person able to do what? Both. Both. Clinton, Trump, no fear of God whatsoever. Not a scrap of fear. Nothing. They'll say anything you need to hear. And don't have one scrap of sting in their conscience. Why? They have no fear of God. What can the Holy Ghost give you tonight? There it is, John 14. You can trade your fear and your cowardice, your shyness and your anxiety tonight. You can trade it in for peace. People who are at peace are not dismayed. People who have fear make bad choices. Do not act like a coward. Do not let your heart be troubled. Don't act like a coward. Acts chapter 9, the disciples took Paul by night. They laid him down in a basket. And when he came to Jerusalem, he wanted to see the other disciples. He wanted to tell them what a great person he had become. He's a great preacher now. He's saved. And guess what? They didn't want to see him. Why? They panicked. People are afraid of other people because of their track record. And after you get saved, sinners won't give you a restart. They won't hit a restart button. Relatives won't hit a restart. They will only remember the crap in your past. Don't tell me I don't know what I'm talking about. I do. They remember the old you. You don't have any faith in this one. Indeed. They didn't believe he was there. They thought he was lying. Why? Because he had lied before. He was a pathological liar and a serial killer. He would lie like crazy to find out if there was a Christian in there, and then they'd drag him out and kill him. You can't trust people that are lying or debating. So Barnabas intercedes for Paul, whom they were not afraid of. Barnabas had their trust. They were not afraid of him. So Paul needed an intermediary. You have an intermediary. The Holy Ghost is with you. They said, hey, he's a different guy now. Chill yourselves out. And I'll be darned, he was a different guy. He starts telling him all these wonderful things he did. Hebrews 11, by faith Moses, when he was born, was hid 3 months from his parents. He was supposed to have been turned over and killed. They saw he was, and I kind of relate to this, Astagus, a really gorgeous, good-looking guy. And I got him beat on the outfits. They saw this kid was a total knockout, most beautiful baby they'd ever seen. And they said, you know what? We can turn him over. He could be killed, but we're not afraid. We're not going to panic. What happened? You don't understand, or maybe you do. One little life can change so many others when there's no fear involved. One life. Those parents weren't afraid. They took that gorgeous kid, put him in that basket and shoved him out. Why? Because they didn't panic. They were not dismayed. They made the right choice because fear was gone. Millions of Jews, and in 2016, there's a nation of Israel right now. Why? Two parents took the baby without fear, put him in the water and turn him over to Jehovah. Jehovah floats him down the stream and plops him there. Oh, man. You don't understand. Don't be afraid of them. Be strong and of good courage. I've got that covered, the Holy Ghost says. I was there before you got there. What's God want you to do? Well, thanks for asking. 2 Timothy 1, here's what he wants you to do. You like prophetic words, do you? Okay. I put you in remembrance, Timothy. Now, what happened to poor Timothy? Timothy, unfortunately, temporarily, had turned into an American Christian. He had a yellow streak down his back. And Paul got a hold of him again because he saw Timothy's incredible potential. He saw the potential in this kid of being a monster Holy Ghost preacher. He saw it. But circumstances, trials, tribulations, pressures, different things had beaten Timothy down. So Paul, instead of abandoning him, comes back, anazo, pareo, and he tells him to relight the fire. It was burning, and then the thing went out. I'm talking about you tonight. You were burning, but the thing went out. You had your call. Fear snuck in. Then cowardice caused you to withdraw. Paul Paul said, I can't let that happen. I want you to stir up, relight it, relight your fire. Who relighted? Timothy. God's not going to come down here tonight. Trust me on this one. This is prophetic. God's not going to come down here tonight, slap you across the face, and drag you down here. Here, get down here. Brother mine, come over here. Put your hand on their head. He's not going to do that. He's not going to do that. God only works with volunteers. You have to stir up, rekindle. You had it before, and then it fizzled out. You, don't be afraid of them. Be afraid of this, not doing it. Acts 18. Paul was in the same spot Timothy got in. So he had what we counselors call what? Empathy. Your ability to see something from that person's perspective. That's empathy, not sympathy. Sympathy is a different concept. Paul had empathy for Timothy because he was starting to sink. Why? Good God, who wouldn't sink? Jews beating the heck out of you, Romans chasing you everywhere, famine, starving, bleeding, beat up, in jail, stuck in stocks. Hey, I got no criticisms of Paul. I wouldn't have made it 2 days under his life. What's happening? The Holy Ghost is going to come to you and say, hey, I need to talk to you. I know you're having a hard time right now. I see that. I understand fear of the future is starting to sink in. That's the worst fear to have. Fear of your future is the worst thing you can have. Because it causes you to develop hopelessness. Once you develop hopelessness, the train just stops. Paul, I know you're struggling right now. I know you're in trouble. Hey, I'm with you. I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. I've got you right here. And I want to encourage you. Paul later did it to Timothy. Don't you see, the trials and tribulation and pain, the suffering and the agony that you have gone through in your life, and it's been terrible. And God knows it's terrible. He wants to turn that around so you can help somebody else. The Holy Ghost never wastes anything. If you take a beating, He will help you through it, remember it, so you can help Him through His. Paul, listen. I know you're getting the stuffing kicked out of you, but when things go bad, I know, I created humans, they get fearful when things go bad. They get scared when their future, to them, looks bleak. See? Correct? I see what you're thinking. I hear you. I love you. Listen, don't be afraid. I got this thing covered. Just speak out boldly. Speak out boldly. I'm going to take care of you. And later on, he did the same thing to Timothy. And later on, I'm sure, Timothy did it for somebody else. And at some point in your life, somebody in your past came to you and said, hey, let's go a little forward here. Let me help you. Something. Somebody showed up out of the blue. Something happened you wasn't expecting. You don't understand. That was the Holy Ghost. You can't see Him. No one can see Him. He's never been seen before. Not in this world or in heaven. There's no record of anyone ever seeing the Holy Ghost. He's always invisible. He's always there. He's like the wind. You can't see the wind unless you're panicking like Peter. But you can see the results of the wind. Something came into your life. Somebody said something. A little thing happened. You go, that's odd. It wasn't odd. It wasn't odd. It was him.
Yes.
It was him leaving you a little message. Sometimes just a little message will get some people over the hump. Some people need what? The blessing of the boot up the butt to get them over the hump. But the key is get over that hump. Get over the hump. And listen, stubborn people need their butts kicked. And the Holy Ghost never gives you more than you can bear, but he will allow a good, just as they say on the street, an ass whooping to come your way to get you over that hump. But some people don't need a beating to get over that hump. I needed a beating to get over my hump. Okay? Was I rejoicing over getting my face kicked in? No, I wasn't. I'll be honest with you. Can I be honest? Huh? No, I didn't like it. I didn't like it. But people that are stubborn have to take a whooping. It's called chastisement. But chastisement, Paideon, is discipline in Greek. Discipline. It's not vengeance whipping. I'm fussing at what you did. Give me that whip. No, that's not father. Father don't whip people. Never whips people. It's discipline that comes from love. Is it fun while you're going through it? Paul told the Corinthians, no, it's not fun. No, it's not. I get it. Yeah. I mean, I got a whole rack of stuff in my life, you do too, that absolutely sucked. I hated some of it. I mean, hate. Later on, when somebody else had what I had, I was able to go back there and help here. Listen, Paul, I know you're down right now, but crank it up. Don't be afraid, because fear will shut you down. And he won't speak. Fear causes you to pick up a coward demon who causes you to, you won't say anything. I don't want to say anything. I don't want to be seen. I don't want to be known. I'll just hide under this rock. No, climb out from under the rock. Nobody's going to hurt you. I am with you. I have many people here. And guess what? God blessed him for a year and a half. All kinds of converts. What's God trying to tell you? Do not be afraid. Speak and hold your peace. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Any questions here in this section? Any questions here in this section? There's a question back there. All right.
Yeah, fear could mean false evidence appearing real. Goliath lost a battle to David while he was still standing because he had no control over his mind.
Good. Anybody else here in this section? Nobody? Yeah.
I have a praise report for you.
Oh, praise the Lord.
A year ago, when I landed in the hospital with bronchial pneumonia and atrial fib, I had a chest x-ray done, and they told me I had a nodule on the right lower lobe of my lung. Yesterday, I went in and had a chest x-ray done. Praise God, my chest was clear, and there is no more nodule.
Fear not, for I am with thee. Anybody over here? Comments, questions? All right, let's close in prayer then. Thank you, Lord. Father, I took a look, hard target look at your word tonight. It was spectacular as usual. Yes. Your word is fantastic. It's the backbone of everything I've got, everything I'll ever get, everything I'll ever hope for. It's the backbone of everything we have here. It's the backbone of our futures. And we thank you for it, Lord. We truly do. Father, there's some people here tonight that are struggling with the big three. Fear, cowardice, and anxiety. And those three things are blocking them from fulfilling their destiny and fulfilling their call in life and their ministry. It's blocking their anointing. It's causing all kinds of problems. Personal problems, financial problems, marital problems, problems with children, everything. It causes everything. Fear causes nothing but confusion. And tonight, Lord, we're going to have a fear eradication service.
Yes.
And these fear spirits and these coward spirits that are dogging your children tonight are going to be broken off. Their hold is going to be snapped off. And we are going to be strong and of good courage tonight. We're going to step out on our faith and believe and trust. And you will not fail us. You will not forsake us. You will not let us down. I'm quoting you, Lord. Behold, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Lord, that's what you said, and that's what we're going to trust tonight. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Thank you for coming to your Friday night Bible study. Now, there's a restroom back there. As you know, there's one on the outside where that guy there standing blocking that door. See that guy right there blocking the door? Somebody get that guy. There's a restroom out there. We're going to take a 5-minute break. We're going to have a fear removal service tonight. Fear paralyzes people's lives. And fear causes people not to believe. And they don't have any faith. And when they don't believe and they don't have any faith, their environment deteriorates. Their health deteriorates. Their mental status deteriorates. Everything the devil gets his filthy claws into suddenly starts deteriorating. That's his specialty. Well, he's going to get him a whoop in the night. I should have got more than 2 amens. I got one from the lady. The only amen I got was a pillow lady. That hurts. All right, 5 minutes. We'll take a 5-minute water break. Thank you. Our training materials back here on the left, CDs, books, streamers. Do not click off on that computer, please. We'll be right back. We'll be right back in a minute. Okay, streamers, here we go. Streamers. Ready for a prayer service now. Who's that guy right there? Who's this guy?
That's her husband.
Who's this guy?
This is my rich
dad. That he related to you?
Yeah, it's my friend. I think so.
Oh, okay. Yeah. His name Danny?
Yeah.
Okay. Can we pray for him tonight?
Yeah, he has a Parkinson's disease.
Oh, Parkinson's. Okay. Who are you? Oh, your wife? Okay. You a Christian? You Buddhist? You Catholics? See you Catholic? Thank you, Lord. Streamers, we're ready to go now. Now, we turn the lights off here at the House of Healing so people can have some visual privacy. And then the people that are going to be laying hands on you and praying for you, they'll have badges on. And if they don't have a badge on, it's okay for them to pray for you, but just don't let them put their hands on you. Okay? They can pray for you, and that's fine. Appreciate that. But just don't put their hands on you if they don't have a badge on you. Okay? And the lights are down. You won't be able to see too much. But people, when they get prayed for, sometimes they get a little self-conscious. So I turn the lights down so they feel a little more comfortable and not feel like everybody's staring at them. Particularly tonight when you have people here with fear spirits. Fear spirits will try to panic the person and they'll talk to them while they're standing there praying, saying, hey, somebody's looking at you and you don't, you're not praying right. They'll say all kinds of weird things in your mind, right? And they'll just float in there, and then that blocks your prayers, and then you can't get healed. Okay? So we're trying to alleviate that issue. Okay? Now, the big three we went over in the Bible study tonight were what? Fear, cowardice, anxiety. Okay? Those three things rot your life out. And I didn't mention this in the Bible study. Fear spirits let in spirits of infirmity, and the person gets sick. Did you hear me? They start coming down with illnesses, strange illnesses that don't respond to medical treatment and don't respond to medication. Do you hear me, sir? The fear spirit lets in the other spirit. So the person starts getting strange illnesses. Sometimes it's Parkinson's. The devil, he thinks. Christians, they don't think, they just kind of react to things. But my job is to help us think about what he's doing. Okay? All right. Okay, well, our ministry team is going to come down the front to help me tonight. Thank you, Jesus. And now, if you have one of those big three that's paralyzing you, okay, I want you just to stand up right now and just come stand right here, right along the front here, facing me. Just stand right here, facing me. You can leave him there. We'll come to him. Let me see. Stand right up here. Good. Just stand right up here near the front. Well done. Now, the first thing I need you to do when you're dealing with people with fear spirits, scoot up here, is you got to try and get the person to relax before you start praying, okay? You hear me?
Yes.
And so what you do, you just simply close your eyes, you know, and you take a couple of big breaths, and you just let your body kind of relax. You see that? Let the tension out of your body. Close your eyes there. Just close your eyes and relax. Yeah, good. Just like this guy here. Perfect. Perfect. Yeah. More relaxing needing here. Yes, feel that? Stress there, that's a spirit. The spirit will stress you out. Feeling there? That was him moving. Just relax, sweetheart. Take a big relax. Let your body loosen up and relax. Thank you, Jesus. Good, very good. Yeah, you take a breath like this guy did. Take a big breath and let your body relax. Here, try and do it. The lights are low, so nobody is looking at you. No one can see you, okay? You're among friends here. You just take a big relax. Thank you, Jesus. Close your eyes. Okay? Just focus on the Lord. Sweet Holy Spirit, look at these beautiful people standing here. Look at them. These are the people you want. These are the people you love. And they're hurting tonight. They're hurting. And you are the only person who can help them. Thank you, Jesus. You're the only person that can help them. They picked up fear spirits in grade school. From ugly people, from bad men, bad husbands. Ugly men hurt some of them and gave them fear. Betrayal, people who betrayed them, gave them fear spirits. Come over here, sweetheart. Now, just take a breath. Just calm down. You're among friends here. Okay? Here, come up here. There you go. Just relax. Thank you, Jesus. We're just relaxing right now, giving the Holy Spirit whatever time he needs to touch people's minds. He's able to touch their minds. He's telling you that I love you. I love you and I care for you. I know about those people that hurt you and used you. I know the devil sent people to hurt you, but I love you, and my peace I'm going to give to you tonight. Fear causes confusion. It causes cowardice. It causes you not to seek help. It causes you not to pray. Causes you to run. Thank you, Jesus. It causes you to develop a hard heart. You get a hard heart when you have fear. You know why? It's a defense mechanism. The devil tells you that will help you survive. And it actually makes you sicker. You will now open your heart to the Lord now. You will release this demon of fear from your body. Come out of there. You will release him in just a minute. You will release him in just a few moments. That fear spirit's going to leave you. And you're not going to be depressed anymore. Clinical depression. Right here. That deep-seated anger that hides in there, that was let in by a fear spirit. Bitterness and anger toward others. There he comes. Here he comes. He's coming up now. Come out. Open your mouth. There he comes right there. There he is right there. There he is right there. Come out right now. Come out. Just relax. It's the Holy Ghost starting to move now. You just relax. He can heal you. Okay. All these ugly men, come up here, honey. We're going to let every person that verbally abused you and spoke evil into your soul, come on, they're all going to come out right now. Take a breath and breathe. Breathe. There he is. All these disappointments. All those disappointments you've had to face over the years. All those disappointments.
Up and out here. Come out.
You're going to release him to the Lord tonight, right now. You're going to release him tonight. There he comes. They're coming up now. There it comes. Come up right now. Come up right now. There they come. Hold that. Hold that. Satan, loose your hold. Satan, loose your hold. Disappointments and heartache. Come out of her. Every ugly man that ever touched her, come out. Come out of that body right now. Come out of that body right now. Come out of that body right now. Go now. Go now. Who did it? What happened? From what age?
Fear, anxiety, cowardice. Come out of me now in the name of Jesus.
Parents?
Come out.
Who?
Go.
Wives. Kids. What? Were you scared in grade school? When did it start? Okay. You're a Christian, aren't you? Yeah, I know. Take a big breath. Now just use your mind. Just scream in your mind, not out loud. Spirit of fear, I command you to break this curse off of me right now. And I command you in the name of Jesus, this curse of fear, through the blood of Christ, I command you to come out of me right now. Come out of my body right this second. Come out of there. Demon of fear, come out of my stomach. Come out of my intestines. Come out of my body right now. Come out of my body right now. Come out of my body right now. Tell the spirit of fear to come out. In the name of Jesus, you spirit of cowardice, come out. Come out now. There he is. Come out right now. Come out. Go right now. Demon of fear and cowardice, I bind your power. Come out of my body right this second. Come out. Keep coughing. Keep coughing. Come out right now. Use your mind and scream at him in your mind. Get out of my body right now. Get out of my body right now.
What was his name? The man. The man. What did he do to you?
What did he do to you?
Very abusive, physically, mentally.
What was his name?
Bob Stewart.
So close your eyes. Take a big breath. Take a big breath. Take a big breath. Take a big breath. Bob. Breathe out of your mouth. And I'm gonna pray for you right now. Father, in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus Christ, this beautiful woman's dad abused her, and he let in a spirit of fear. And that spirit of fear drew in other men later in life, and they used her and abused her too. They used her body for sex. They used her time. They took her money, and they betrayed her. And tonight, that spirit is coming out. Bob, you come out of this woman of God right now. I release my dad. There he is. I release my dad. Bob, come out of her right now. Come out right now. I release my dad for the rest of my life. Come out right now. Come out. I give him to the Lord. I let him go right now. And most of all, I forgive him. And I release him. Dad abused her. Just use your mind and scream at him right now. Spirit of cowardice and shyness, I command you in the name of Jesus. Spirit of fear and cowardice, I command you in the name of Jesus Christ. Be of good courage. Be of good courage. Come out of my head right now. Come out, you demon of fear. Come out, you fear. Right now in Jesus' mighty name. Come out of my stomach. Come out of my stomach. Spirit of infirmity, come out of me right now in the name of the Lord Jesus. I rebuke fear and cowardice. I rebuke fear and cowardice. Keep coughing. Come out right now. I rebuke fear and cowardice. Come out right now. 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 Go. Let him go.
Get out.
Just get mad. You have the anointing. You're not using it. You have the anointing. Those demons that just came out wouldn't have come out if you didn't have the anointing. You have it.
Get out.
You have it.
Let him go. Come on.
You have it. Oh, thanks for asking. Close your eyes. I command you, spirit, in the name of Jesus Christ, to get out of my body right now. By the authority of the Word of God, I bind your power. Come out. I bind your power. Come out of my body right now. Right this second. Spirit of fear, come out. There he comes. Come out. Come out. There he is right there. Come out. Come out. Lucy. Satan, loose your hold. Cowardice, come out.
Go!
Right now! Come out! Come out of there! All of you! All of them! All of them! All of them right now! Go in Jesus' mighty name! Get out of my throat! Take a breath and blow. Blow. Keep blowing. Come out of him. Come out of him. All the way from childhood, you get out of him. All the way from childhood, all the beatings, all the verbal abuse. Come out now. Come out now. I forgive myself for my mistakes and my failures. I'm forgiving myself right now for my mistakes and my failures. I forgive myself right now. Come out of there. What you need, hon?
Oh, they already helped me. He did a really good job. I felt it. Like,
you leave?
Yes.
You speak in tongues?
No, I have a guy.
Oh, okay. Stand right here. And just pray after me. Burra baba. Kelo masi. Venoma. Burra shata. Kelo vashike. Notice how easily you're repeating that? You already have your gift of tongues, you just haven't released it. All Christians have it. They just haven't released it. And they usually don't release it because they get bad teaching. And it blocks it. All you have to do is relax. Yeah. Any syllable. Satan, I hate your guts. You stole 50 years of my life and wasted it. 50 years of my life wasted. You're not going to waste another minute. Now, let me go. Let me go, I said. Let me go. Let me go. Go! The stinking depression, I bind your power. Come out of the man of God right now. Go! Take a breath and blow. Come out of there. Come out right now. Come out right now. Here he comes. Come out of there. Come out. Come out of his body. Fear, heaviness. Come out right now. Fear and heaviness. Come out right now. Come out right now. Agonizing fear. Fear of my children's future. Come out of me right now. Demon of fear from the mother. Leave the daughter. Come out of my body right now. I bind you depression. I command you to come out. I say that. I command you in the name of Jesus. Is it gone? Appreciate you. Say that. In the name of Jesus, I bind the spirit of heaviness and I command it to come out. Lord, forgive me for passing the spirit of fear onto my daughter. Forgive me, Lord. Forgive me, Lord Jesus. Is this guy born again? Can he hear me? Can he hear me? Can he hear me?
Yes, he can hear you.
Hi, Dan. Hi, Mike. Nice to meet you. Nice to meet you. All right. Are you a Christian?
Yeah.
You are? Okay. Have you turned your heart over to the Lord? Have you repented of your sin? Have you turned your heart over to the Lord?
Oh, yeah.
You have?
Yeah.
And you've got Parkinson's?
Yeah.
Okay, now listen, Parkinson's is usually a spirit that comes down from the family tree. Usually somebody else in the family has it up the family tree. Yes. Normally. Huh?
Yes.
So, yes?
He has five brothers.
Do they have Parkinson's? He has five brothers, they all have Parkinson's? Okay, this is a curse. This is a curse on this family. He has six of them with Parkinson's. That's crazy. I never even heard of that. Okay? Right? That's a family. Yeah, we got to break it off of it. Satan, in the name of Jesus Christ, I bind your power. I break this filthy Parkinson's curse. Break off this body in Jesus' mighty name. I go back 10 generations and break this evil curse off his body in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Come out of that body right now in Jesus' mighty name. Come out in Jesus' name. Parkinson demon, come out in the name of... Come out right now. Come out right now. Parkinson's, Catholic spirits, Mother Mary demons, come out in Jesus' mighty name. How's she doing right here? What's your name, sweetheart?
Karen.
Karen, what do you need? What's going on?
She's having to release her ex.
Well, what's his name?
Craig.
Craig, what do you do to you? What do you do to you?
I was dating him. I found out he was married.
Okay, Craig. Okay, now here's
the tingling in her arms and her legs.
Yeah, those are spirits moving around your body. Okay, now Craig's in there.
And my jaw is like wants to shake.
Okay, now was there witchcraft in your family tree or New Age? How about his?
I don't know about his, but my sister believes in that Wiccan.
Oh, your sister the Wiccan? Did she ever put a curse on you? Has anybody ever put a curse on you? Anybody?
Not that I know of.
Okay. Well, let's start with Craig then. Craig. All right, raise your hands. Just do what I tell you. Close your eyes. Close your eyes. Take a big breath. Father God, I'm asking you right now to bless Craig wherever he is. He lied to me and he betrayed me. Come out in Jesus' holy name. Okay. Come out in the name of the Lord. Satan, loose your hold. Is he about to throw up? Is he about to throw up? Is he going to throw up? Oh, he drools? Okay. Lift your legs. Lift your legs. Tell him to do something he couldn't do before.
Can't stand up. Huh? He can't stand up.
Can he go like that? Could he do that before?
Yeah.
Can he do that before?
A little bit.
Does he speak English?
Yeah. Raise both of your arms then.
No. Tell him to try something he couldn't do before. See if any of the spirits will come out. Talk to him. What's bothering you? Who are you? Husband? Your son. What's wrong with your mom? Tell me right now. Yeah. Well, what's the problem? You were an addict?
Yeah.
No, yeah, not no more. You were an addict, right? What were you on?
Meth.
You're on meth, right? Okay, now listen. Meth is a dangerous drug. Not in the way you think. It let them in. And if you don't get them out, later.
And I want to ask for forgiveness for anything I ever done as a child. As an adult, I just want to ask for forgiveness.
Ask her to forgive you?
Yeah,
oh, please, because if you hurt her, that brought a curse on you. Go ahead and apologize to her. Is it gone? Is it gone?
Still.
Okay, now put your hands right here. Now you use that scripture I gave you. Behold, I give you power to tread on scorpions and serpents and over all the power of the enemy. And it. Hey. Don't leave, okay? Over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. This is spiritual. I do not have depression. That's a lie. That is a spirit, and I command that spirit to come on my body in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Okay, now Mom, when did you start taking meth? When? What age? I know. What age? How old are you? Okay, you started meth at what age? 40? Before that it was? Meth started at what age? 20s? And then before that, somebody hurt you real bad. Who was it? You got raped at what age? 21. What was his name?
Albert.
And was it a forcible rape? Or a drug rape? Or a date rape? Or what? How did it work? You got kidnapped and raped? Okay. Now, the fear demon got in then when she got kidnapped. Okay. And also another spirit got in who were a rejection demon. But that feels like it got in before that. Was you abused as a child? Or beat up or something? Or molested? Got molested by who? By who? Who? Family member? What's their first name? Uncle. What's his first name? He's not here, is he? Not the whole name, the first name. Jerry. Now, how old were you?
13.
Was you a virgin then? Okay. Now, the rejection demon got in at 13, and then the fear demons jumped in later. See? And then later on, they turned her into an addict. It never was your mom. Okay? So right now, you need to turn your heart over to the Lord and listen to me carefully. God is not mad at you. He never has been. He saw you get molested. He saw you get raped. And he's never been mad at you, not even for 1 minute. The low self-esteem and the low self-concept you develop came from them. Right? You believe me? Okay, raise your hands, close your eyes. Thank you, Jesus. Raise your hands. Dear Lord Jesus, pray after me. Dear Lord Jesus, I need to be forgiven tonight for trying to kill myself through drugs, for hating myself, for rejecting myself, for turning my back on you, for having low self-esteem and low self-concept, and hiding behind drugs and alcohol. And tonight, Lord, I'm going to repent of my sin. I'm going to forgive these men and what they've done to me. I'm going to forgive these men and what they've done to me. The rapist, the child molester, my relative, I give them to you, Lord. I ask you to forgive them. And I ask you to forgive me for destroying my life on meth and alcohol and bad men. Broken relationships, self-hatred, self-disgust. God, forgive me. The Bible says that you unconditionally love me. And tonight I'm going to receive that love for the first time in my life. 100%. I'm giving you my heart. And I'm asking you to forgive me for the pain I caused my family. Worry and fear over my addictions. Hurting my loved ones and hurting myself. I'm asking you to forgive me, Lord. Right now, in the name of Jesus, the Son of God. And I ask you to give me the Holy Spirit tonight. So I can have peace and joy that I've never known. Peace and joy for me tonight. In Jesus' holy name. Amen. Thank you, Lord. I want more, Lord. Take a big breath. Breathe. Breathe. Take a big breath. Take a big breath. Big breath. Good. Holy Spirit, good. Breathe again. Holy Spirit, come in. Touch. Breathe. Holy Ghost, come in. Demon of meth, I bind your power. I curse your work. Stop trying to kill her. Stop tormenting her with nightmares and dreams. Stop putting chronic negative thoughts into her mind. Stop it right now. Big breath. Holy Spirit, come in. You speak in tongues? Okay, take a big breath. Satan, I command you to release my mother right now. In the name of Jesus Christ, let her go. Let my mother go. Breathe. Breathe out your mouth. Come out. Devil, come out of there right now. Go. Meth. Bad men. Rejection. Come out. In the name of the Lord. Now go. Come out of my head. Depression, come out of my head right now. Every curse, break off the man of God. Catholic curses. Witchcraft curses. Sorcery curses. Iniquity curses. Every one of them. Break off in Jesus' holy name. Break off in the name of Jesus. Break off. Break off in Jesus' name. Let my mother go in Jesus' mighty name. Let my mother go right now. Let my mother go. Heal. Get that fear demon out of your stomach right now. How's she doing?
She got a lot out.
Atta, what's left in there? What's your name, hon?
My name's Nancy.
Nancy, oh, you're a beautiful person. What else is left in there?
Your mom nitpicked her.
Your mom did what here?
Self, just everything, you know.
What's her first name?
Mary.
Okay.
You know what?
Now,
just...
I want to explain something to you. When a child dishonors their parent, a curse falls on the kid. And it's not true of any other relationship. Husband to wife, wife husband, parents to kids. There's no curse transfers. But if a child degrades or hurts or does something to their mother or dad, a curse falls on you. And then the person's life goes bad.
So my hatred for the Higgins, Bob, sorry.
And their life goes bad. Financially, emotionally, physically, financially. Everything goes bad. And then all the relationships break up. Boom, boom, boom. They all explode over the years. So right now, what we got to do with Mary, is she still alive? All right, good. Close your eyes. Lord, I want you to hunt Mary down tonight. She sinned against her daughter and the sins that she committed verbally and physically. We know they were wrong and we do not agree with them or condone them in any way. Take a big breath. Atta girl. Breathe. Come on. We do not condone them in any way. But the devil used the mother to put a curse on the daughter. And she had a period of time in her life where she hated her mother. And that finished her. And tonight she's going to repent. There he is. There she is. Mary, come out of her. Mary, come up. Curse, you come off the woman of God. Mary, wherever you are, we are blessing you right now. Matthew chapter 5 says, there he is. Come out. Here comes Mary's demons. Come out. Break off curse. There it comes. It's coming. Get out of the body. There it comes right there. Go. I forgive Mary. I forgive Mary. I release her to God. I bless my mother. I forgive her for what she did. I release her from my soul right now in Jesus' name. Come out right now. Come out. Mary, come out. Curse, break off. Break. Break off right now. Streamers, if you had an abusive mother or dad and you cursed your parents or you hated them, you hung yourself. You hung yourself. You ruined your life. The demons put a curse on you. And we're going to break it off right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, I forgive my mom and dad. Hey, did you put a curse on yourself? Did you mistreat your parents? When you were younger? You did? Okay, now let's break the curse off. Ready? Raise your hands. Father God, years ago, I dishonored and disrespected my parents. And the demons put a curse on me. And then later on, they gave me fear demons. And ruined my life. And then they put me in the medical system and they said I was mentally ill. And I caused it all unknowingly because I hurt myself because I cursed my mother. And my father. And I took in a curse. There it comes. I took in a curse, and I'm paying for it to this day. So I lift my parents up to you, Lord, and I bless them. I forgive them for what they did. I ask you to heal and deliver them if they're still alive. If they're not alive, I release their ugly demons from my body. I release their spirits from my spine, my back, my intestines, my stomach. I command this curse to break off me right now. 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 After you got a curse put on you, streamers, later on in life you became promiscuous. And then you started picking up demons from other people. Ladies, let me talk to you. Spirits can transfer during intercourse with infected men. Men, let me talk to you. If you play around and whore yourself out, you can pick up spirits from women. While you're committing adultery and fornicating, or you marry some guy with demons, he started out great, he's real sweet, or she started out wonderful, oh, she's so nice, and they turned out to be hell on wheels. Those spirits can transfer into your body. Come out of there. Come out. Go right now. Come out right now. Every woman. Every one of them women go. Every one go. Every girlfriend. Come out right now. Those spirits can transfer into your body from a spouse. Most people do not know that. They can transfer from a spouse. All you have to do is repent of it, and you can get that spouse, that curse, that spirit out of your life forever. I'll help you do it. Streamers, let's do it. Father God, in Jesus' holy name, I'm asking you to forgive me for committing adultery, for fornication, for marrying somebody I should have never married, for sleeping around. I ask you to forgive me for sleeping around and committing adultery. And for the transfer spirits I picked up, I'm going to repent of it right this second. I apologize to you, Lord, for what I've done. I disobeyed the word of the God, Lord. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Well, I ignored it, and I did it. And I picked up a curse. I picked up spirits from that person. I shouldn't even have shaken their hands, let alone slept with them. And the devil beat me, got me. And I developed the same sicknesses that person had. Rotten luck, bad finances, broken relationships, lousy friends, broken career, lousy... Yes, sir. How'd you do that? Oh, what'd you do to him?
I just remember like, like I said some hurtful things to them, like I hate you. And, like,
they still alive?
What?
Are they alive?
Yeah, they're alive.
Oh, great. Good. Now, here's what we do. You can break that curse off right now. Let's do it. Matthew chapter 5 says, love your enemies. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who despitefully use you and abuse you. Right now, Lord, I lift up his parents to you. He dishonored them, and there he is. He dishonored his parents and picked up a curse. And it's coming out tonight because he's asking for forgiveness. And we are blessing both of them. That was a sin, what he done. That was a sin, what he done. And he's repenting of it right this second. He's repenting of it right this second. Hold that. Come out right now, spirit. Right now. There he is. Come out right now. Come out of there. Come out, you curse mother. Come out.
Come out.
Go now. Come out now. There it goes. There it goes. Come out now. Dad, go now.
Come out.
Go now. Dad, go now. I forgive you. I release you. Forgive me, Father, for hurting my mom and dad. That was wrong. I was wrong. And I repent of it right now. In Jesus' mighty name, I repent of it right now. Come out right now. Go now. Come out right now. Go right now. Right now. If you picked up a transfer spirit from some woman or man you were dating, you should never even have gone over to their house, let alone slept with them. You picked up a transfer. You better. Oh, thank you.
Appreciate it.
Come back. Love you. If you picked up a transfer spirit from some rotten person, spouse or friend or whoever, or if you got date raped, or you got drunk one night, you did something you shouldn't have done, they transfer in, and you got to get them out of there. You got to get them out of there. The Bible says, whatever a man sows, that he shall also reap. This lady here got healed tonight from sowing dishonor to her parents. She repented of it.
Amen. Praise God.
And she just reaped a healing. Whatever you sow, that's what you will reap. You sow what's right. It's the law of the spirit world. How you doing? What do you need?
I'm doing fine.
You're doing
great.
Who else needs prayer? Come up here quickly. Yes, sir.
Maybe you can give me a little check up here. I think I'm pretty confident that I got rid of the fear because I feel
joyous. Right, you speak in tongues?
No.
Okay. Now that's all you're lacking. Now, streamers, I want to talk to you for a minute. What's your name?
Mike.
Mike. My name's Mike too. Nice to meet you.
Yes, Mike.
Mike just got delivered from fear spirit tonight. and he feels joyous inside. That's a red flag. The thing is gone. Because fear spirits are the polar opposite of joy. I don't mean fun. That's a human thing. Joy is a spiritual thing. And all born-again Christians have their gift of tongues because they have the Holy Spirit living in their spirit, man. And he has everything, not just the gift of prayer language, tongues. He's got your anointing, your ministry, all your other gifts. He's got everything. The Holy Ghost has got everything. Then everything else on top of that. Plus more than that. Plus everything on top of that. He's got everything. But the reason that people don't speak in tongues is because they don't release it. You already have it, they're just not releasing it. Usually from bad teaching. They get bad teaching on it, and then that stops it, blocks it. But all you have to do is relax and just kind of release it. See? You just kind of close your eyes. Repeat after me. Kuramasha. Velova. Velomasite. Yekumama. Alushita. See how easy you're repeating that? You happen to notice that? There's nothing. It's a very good sign. Okay. Now I'll show you how to do the laughter thing after that. I'll teach you that in a minute. Okay. Now you just try, go with me again. And this time you add some syllables on your own. Just relax and just kind of release any syllable. There's no wrong answer. There's two types of tongues. The Greek word is glossa. There's one tongues for giving messages in church. That's the gift of tongues, to give a message. Most people don't have that gift. The other one is your prayer language, where you can pray in glossa. And when you pray in glossa, the devil doesn't know what you're saying. If you pray in English or Spanish, they know all them languages. So they'll know what you're saying, so they'll try to block the prayer somehow. But when you pray in glossa, 1 Corinthians 14, it has a long laundry list of spiritual benefits. One of them is praying like the CIA. It's a secret code in a way. You pray in glossa and the Holy Spirit interprets it. You have to have an interpreter when you're speaking in tongues, and the Holy Ghost interprets it. And then he applies it wherever you need it. And it causes you to grow spiritually fast. You kind of grow like a weed. See? But all you have to do is relax. Good. Keep going. Good. Yeah. Just follow him. Follow him speaking in tongues. Can you hear him? There you go. You speak in tongues? Okay. Did you hear me telling him that? Did you hear me telling him about tongues? Hey, you just repeat after me. Bushabba. Busha Mashede Velovava Roboshande Yekovashata. Any change? Hey. Slight. Anything?
He tried standing up, it was slight. But I just asked him right now if he wanted to be born again. And I prayed with him. And he did utter and say it's part of that. It's part of me. I prayed with him, so I think in his heart he's saying that he wants to be born again, that he wants to be born again.
That guy is speaking in tongues for the first time in his life. Guy in black shirt right there. It's your prayer language. Good, keep going. Well, how are we doing here?
He's blocking me.
What's going on here?
I just came here to get prayer for my healing. I don't feel like I want to cough anything up.
Well, that's okay. You don't have to cough.
I mean, like, I mean, if I had to, I would, but I don't believe there's something to cough up.
Okay. That's no problem. Now, what's in there? Have you got any negative emotions about anybody?
Not anymore.
How about yourself?
Yeah.
Okay, why don't you like yourself?
Because what God had gave me.
What did he give you?
In 2009, he endowed me with the anointing, and I watched him work through me. And
cool.
A few years later, I kind of just joined that with Jezebel.
A woman?
Yeah.
Okay, well, what
was. Told me it was a Jezebel later on.
Yeah, what was her name?
Lisa.
Lisa, okay. And then everything started to go downhill from there?
Right. In 2012, I just went into deep depression.
From?
I wanted to kill myself. Just because I was alone, but she would vex me.
Okay, what's her name?
Alisa,
okay. How'd that go?
Good.
Now, I got one more thing I got to show you.
No, I'm up.
Stay here.
I'll stay.
Hey, now, here's what happened. When you hooked up with, what's her name?
Lisa.
Alisa. You hooked up with Alisa. She had demons. And you're sleeping with her, so they transferred in. Okay? They transfer over during intercourse. That's 2 Corinthians 7. They transfer over in there. Then they let in some other spirits. Okay? Is Alisa still alive? She is? Okay. So we got to do Matthew 5:44 on her. So raise your hands now. The Bible says, love your enemies. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who despitefully use you. Okay, now you let a bad woman into your life, and it was your fault because your discernment was off. And she had Jezebel spirits. Those are actually rebellion demons. They like to control everything and people and situations and things and others and different things. Anyway, these rebellion demons, they got bad tempers and they're mean. And that's the woman you were dating. Were you living with her? You're dating. That's the woman you were sleeping with, what I just described. And we're going to bless her wherever she is. Now, Lord, I want you to hunt down Alisa right now. Right this second. Find her, Lord. Hunt her down. Put your loving hands on her, Lord Jesus. Put your loving hands on her. I want you to tell her that me and Tony, him, everybody here, hopefully, we all forgive her for what she did. And I'm asking you to forgive him for turning his back on you, Lord, and stabbing you in the back, committing adultery, walking away from his anointing and his giftings that he should have never left, not in a million years, but he did. But those sins are 100% forgivable. And the blood that Jesus shed covers every single sin known to man. And he's going to repent of it right now. And we're all going to listen to him do it. Go ahead, sir. Just repent of what you did. You did some horrible things, but you can be forgiven. But you can't be if you don't confess it. Go ahead.
Come out. We cut off all your cords right now. We cut them away from her. Come on.
I confess.
I'll
coil
right now.
How's your tongue's going?
Untwist.
Did you do it?
Untwist.
Okay, now, here's your problem. Let me talk to you for a second. You've got seducing spirits in there, 1 Timothy chapter 4. And what these things do is that they're always putting in negative thoughts into your mind. It's a negative thought. And they come in so naturally, the person doesn't recognize them.
Then when I think,
can you hear something talking to you in your head?
I can hear you, but when you're right. When I'm thinking, the thought comes in.
It's negative. Yeah. Now, those are seducing spirits. They get in your brain. They're very hard to get out.
Yeah, that's right.
And they hate the gift of tongues because they don't know what the person's saying. But if you're talking to me, they know what you're saying. They speak your language, so they put that thought in your mind. And they did it a minute ago. You started to release your prayer language, and then these thoughts came in that were negative, and you stopped. Correct? Yeah. So now you're going to repent of that right now, because you are a born-again Christian. Am I right? Are you saved?
I don't feel saved.
Okay, were you ever saved?
Yes.
When?
When I was like third grade.
All right, did you have the Holy Spirit then? You stopped going to church. Well, church hasn't got anything to do with being saved. Now, were you born again when you were in third grade?
The water come out. Water was just pouring out.
Oh, you felt it.
You felt it, yeah. I started crying. I didn't know what was going on.
Okay. So, now we've established that you're born again. You're saved. No, now. Because you wouldn't be standing here right now if you weren't saved, were you? Why would you come here?
Yeah.
Why'd you come down here?
Because I needed help.
From who?
From the Lord.
Well, of course you came down here for the Lord, because you're a Christian. That's why you came to the Lord.
Yeah.
This isn't rocket science. Okay. So, now you're going to repent of that sin. Right now. And I'll help you. Lord, I'm asking you right now to forgive me for listening to the demons in my mind tell me I wasn't saved. That was a terrible sin. He made me doubt my salvation. He made me doubt my home in heaven. He made me think I was going to die and go to hell. And then he made me feel depressed. And because I felt bad, I believe those lies. And that's the devil tricking me. He's using my emotions against me. And I repent of this right this second. I'll repent of it right now. Go ahead, sir. I repent of thinking I'm not a Christian and I wasn't born again. I repent of it. That was wrong. That's wrong. I am saved. In fact, I started to speak in tongues earlier, and then the demon in my head put a negative thought in there and talked me out of it. Well, that's not going to happen again. Let's go. Raise your hand. Pray harder. There you go. Louder. Hear it coming out? Hearing speaking? This guy, the demons told this guy he wasn't even saved. You can't speak in tongues unless you're saved. That, by definition, you can't. Sinners can't speak in tongues. Can they?
No, come on.
Am I right, sir? You see how smart the devil is? The demons are smarter than we are. They think about stuff and we don't. They had him talked out of his salvation 3 minutes ago. Did you hear me talking to him? Now that's an intelligent spirit to talk a guy out of his salvation. Especially when he started speaking in tongues and then stopped. Now that's smart. Well, they're not smarter than the Holy Ghost. We'll give him a good whipping here. Louder. Come on, just be strong. The reason I'm spending extra time with this guy to get his prayer language is because he has depression. And speaking in tongues will kill depression. It'll crush it. If I can get him to release it, the spirit of heaviness will lift right out of him. So that's why I'm trying to crank this up more. That's why I'm trying to get it going for depression cases. And so you can tell by looking at this guy, he's got a coward demon. Can't you? He's got coward spirits. So then I got to take a little extra time with him. You got to be patient with people and get them to press in and get their miracle. Hey, come here. This gal here has got fibroids. She's going to get healed right now. Stand right here. Thank you, Gina. What's your name, sweetie?
Serena.
Serena. She's beautiful. When? What's the due date here? November 26th? Okay. Now, is there any chance at all? Is it a boy or a girl? What's the name? Adrian. Is there any chance at all anybody put a curse on Adrian in the womb? Has anybody said anything negative about him? Has anybody? Come on. Keep going. Hey, keep going. Did anybody put a curse? Who?
I know this is why I had to come up here, because, you know, I've been learning a lot from you. I read a lot. I try to talk to friends a lot about what they're going through and try to guide them. And we get a lot of backlash, like as if I'm like psycho or something. So it's not that I don't dropped or down or anything, but I just, I feel like me and my family are just being persecuted for the things that we're learning.
Okay.
All right. Okay. We do get a lot of things just from that, not anybody specifically, but that's what it's been like. It's been bothering me.
Okay. Now, what's that on your arm there?
It's a Medusa.
A Medusa. Who? When did you get that on there?
I got that about, I think, 7 years ago.
7 years ago. Okay. Let's start there first. Father God, I ask you to forgive her for what she has done. She cursed herself. She put a flag on her arm telling the devil that she was available for him. She put Medusa on there. That's a familiar spirit, an evil one who brings in sicknesses and illnesses. And we repent of that tattoo. And that witchcraft that she, of her own free will, got involved in. But dear Lord, she was ignorant at the time. She didn't understand. She was cursing herself. And we're asking for forgiveness. The blood of Jesus covers every tattoo. There it is. Come out. Keep coughing. Come out of there. Come out of her stomach. Come out right now. Come out of Adrian right now. Let go of Adrian.
Let go right now. Let go.
There it goes. Got that gun. Okay, now, we got to get rid of the depression here, okay? Now just switch over your gift of tongues and put a little hum to it and just sing the Lord a love song, just like this. Come on, that baby, right now. Come on, baby. Good, beautiful. Let it out. Release it. That's the next thing I was going to show you.
Yes, sir.
You can draw in the Holy Ghost anytime you need him.
Yeah.
Ready?
Yeah.
You just slow your tongues down and just put a little hum to it. Remo shabo lora revura shuri. Undo revo le sholevo. Urorore. Urevura shuri. Onde vorere. Vorere vorere
shuri. Get out. Go. Get out of my body. Go. Get out of my body right now.
Okay, let's try again.
I know something.
Yeah.
I had my two clients following me here from Arizona City tonight. My one client, she has cancer of the kidneys.
Where's she at?
She's less than 10 minutes away. They were following us. And they turned around and went home because he told me she wasn't feeling too good and she couldn't handle it.
Okay.
Another client has got cancer in her adrenal glands. And I tried.
She here?
She won't have it. Okay. This hand's here.
Okay. Now, you got any oil? Ready your head back. Ready?
Yeah.
All right. Father God, this is a curse case. that goes back many generations. These demons have taken this whole family. This is the sixth person that ended up with Parkinson's. I know that's not medical. I know it's demonic. And I want to ask you to give him some faith right now. I want you to download the gift of faith right in here to believe in miracles. To believe in miracles. I want you to give his wife faith right now to believe in miracles. In Jesus' holy name, I'm focusing only on the Son of God, nothing else and no one else. Nothing else and no one else. We anoint him in the name of the Lord. In the name of the Lord, we're going to anoint him with this Holy Ghost oil. I'm asking you to touch his body and break these curses off him and his brothers. Was it brothers?
Brothers.
Brothers? Sisters? Both? Oh my God. Brothers and sisters got the curse. They all ended up with Parkinson's. Father, we place curse of failure on this wicked spirit that brought this demon down through the generations. We bind his power in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. In Jesus' mighty name, anointing and Holy Ghost, go through this body. Go through this body, Spirit of the living God. I pour the blood of Jesus on his body now. Oh Lord, let's go. Heal. Anoint you with oil in the name of the Lord. Be healed. Healed. Curse break off. Snap. All right. Stand up. Stand up. Stand up in Jesus' mighty name. Heal, Lord. Place him in your hands. Stand, rise, and be healed. Curse be broken. In Jesus' name, be broken. Be broken, demon curse. Demon curse, be broken. Break. 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 Filthy curse, break. Break in Jesus' mighty name. Asking me if they felt anything. Asking me if they felt anything.
Parkinson's unclean spirit. Come out of this man.
Parkinson, come out of that body. Come out. Parkinson's, come out. Parkinson's, come out. Come out. Let your tears go. Come on, sweetheart. Come on. You got to get that curse broken off of you right now. Adrian, be healed. Adrian, be healed. Adrian, be healed. Is the depression gone?
Zodiac and astrology right now. Forgive me, Father. Divination.
You don't know. Well, it must be partially gone.
Right now, we ready.
How are you feeling? Worse, better, or
come out. Come out, release her. Come out right now. Come out right now. Come out, sweet little planets and stars, right now.
What's wrong with your name? What is it? Oh, okay.
Moon worship.
You did, okay.
Go,
oh,
come out. Spirits of darkness, right
go.
Now.
Come
out.
What? I came a long
way. Yeah, I know that. Thank you. Thanks for not leaving.
Yeah, I just felt like I had to come back over here.
Good.
I was about to leave.
All right. Now, have you repented of everything?
Amen. Yes.
Everything? You forgave her, Jezebel? Forgave her?
Forgave her.
How about your parents? Did you repent or hurt your parents? Okay. Did we miss anything? All right. Good.
What you said to me really scared me.
Did you repent of that? Let's repent of that first. Go ahead. I repent of being afraid right now. Right now. Being afraid of the doctor said. That was a lie. I don't believe doctors. I believe the great physician. And I'm being healed now. Healed.
Put a curse of failure on you right now in the name
heal.
Of Jesus.
Heal now.
I break your hold.
Be healed in Jesus' mighty name.
Come out right now. I command this curse
now.
I command this curse of okay.
Go take a leak. Go ahead. Back there on the left. Go take a leak and tell me if there's any change. Check out your bladder right now. What's the story? You feel good, okay. Now, listen, we can completely crush this depression. I've had like over 100 people healed of it. Okay? Okay, I got to give you a Bible study. Stay right here. This thing will kill it. Here's all the spiritual benefits of speaking and singing in tongues. You just follow those steps.
Go right now.
And you'll never be bothered again with
that. Venus and arrows, go. Come out. Venus and arrows, come out right now.
Oh, okay. Well, come back. You live around here?
Yes.
Okay. Hey, can I talk to you for a minute? Yeah. How are you?
Good, how are you?
You're beautiful.
Thank you.
What's your need from the Lord here? Tell me about it.
Child sacrifice of this baby right now. Right now. We break the curse of the child sacrifice.
Why are you here?
I brought my friend.
Oh, that one?
Uh-huh.
Oh, okay, good. Now, what's your need? You speak in tongues?
I do.
Okay, let me hear it. Okay, stop. That's excellent. Do you sing in tongues?
I do.
Okay, let me hear that. That's excellent too, only it's a little weak. Okay, raise your hand. What's your name again?
Janelle.
All right, raise your hands here. Now, this will draw in the Holy Ghost anytime you need him. Okay? You have a really nice anointing, but I'm sensing it's blocked, or you're not using it or something. Something's like a cork in a bottle, and that shouldn't be, because you really have you've got the real deal going here. Why are you blocked? Fear. That's an interesting statement. I happen to have taught on that tonight. Do you know that? Fear blocks people's anointing. Now, here's how you can break it. If you have somebody like this woman here, who's already a strong Christian, you handle them different. Hey, did you go to the bathroom? What happened?
It's the same.
It's the same?
It's the weak stream.
It's a wee, okay, stay right. Okay, that should have been healed. Stand up again. Now, did you have any doubts when you walked down there to go pee? Did you have any doubt when you were walking down there? All right. Now, let's try it again. Only this time, stay right there. Let's repent of that doubt. Go ahead. Doubt, fear, and unbelief will block your miracle. And while he was walking down the aisle there, he was healed here, but he lost his healing right about there.
Okay?
Now, Lord, I repent of having doubts in my heart that you will not heal me, or you don't want to heal me, or there's some problem. I repent of it right this second. I have fears and doubts. I have unbelief in my heart, and unbelief is the world's greatest sin for human beings. Unbelief. And I repent of it right now in the name of the Lord Jesus, the Son of God. And I receive my healing without doubting and without questioning in it. I'm receiving because you love me. Heal!
Get out of those tissues right now.
Heal!
Get out of the tissues right now. Get out of the tissues.
Right now.
Get out right now.
Jesus,
get out.
You're
demon of death.
Thank you, Lord, for healing me. I give you praise. Thank you for healing me. Say that. Thank you for healing me, Lord. And I give you praise for healing me. Now, here's how you do it when you have a strong Christian like you. Hey, don't stop. Just one more minute, please. Here's how you do it. You kind of encourage them to take a step out of their comfort zone, and then it just clicks.
Okay.
So, since you're here among friends, you and I are friends now, right?
Uh-huh.
Okay. What you do is you just step out of your comfort zone, and that little act of faith triggers the anointing that you already have.
Okay.
See? So you just push yourself a little. Like this. Romusha bashatre. Lemusha dream. Morava bashatre mushata. Orashala. Voshe moda. Oh, you said, I don't know if I can do that. Did you hear what she said? That was a fear spirit. He put a thought in her mind. And that's that coward spirit I was talking about. Did you hear that? This woman is a perfect demo for my teaching. I hope she comes back every week. Now, you just repent of that. Go ahead. Excellent. Good. You were just forgiven. Harder. That a girl louder. Thank you, Jesus, for healing me tonight. Thank you for forgiving me for all this wickedness I got involved. Thanks for restoring me. I'm asking you to give me back my ministry, my healing ministry in my hands. So every person I ever pray for the rest of my life who has bladder issues, they will be completely healed right on the spot. And I receive that by faith without doubting. Louder. There you go. Good. Louder. Louder. Good. Louder. Good. Louder. Any change? Anything there? Any change at all?
We break your spells. We break your hexes right here. We break your miracles.
Any change? Anything? Can you hear me? Oh. Is there any change at all since you've been praying? Any change anyway? Little bit?
Yeah.
Okay.
We want a little bit more. We want this unclean spirit.
Now, you tell it to come out.
Come on out.
Get out. There you go. Good. See that? Did you feel that when you were saying that?
Yeah.
Oh, now. Okay, let's go to phase two.
Okay.
I'll show you. Corre velo lascio la burri. Andore lascio la burri. Louder. Good. Come out, Satan. Come on, my body. Come out right now. Come on, my body. Get out of my body, spirit. Why? How you doing? What's that girl need right there? That girl right there. No, you're not. What's her name? Go grab her. Bring her. Hey, listen. You've got a nice anointing that's buried in there. This will blow it out the door. You're supposed to be healing people. Healing broken hearts. Women with broken hearts. Abused women. Women are beat up. You wrote a book to do that.
I wrote a book about my life, how God saved me, and that's my dream is to do that.
All right, so that's confirmation. So now you have to get your anointing going and start literally doing it, healing them, literally. Okay, no more stalling. Ah, this girl here. Ah, yeah. Okay. How come he was crying back there?
The Lord was talking to me.
What was he telling you?
He was talking to me about restoring what? Like childhood joy.
Oh, good. Now, when did you lose it?
When I was really young.
And who did it?
My parents.
Which one?
Both of them.
What were they doing to you? Stepdad?
Yeah.
And they got you divorced and you were how old?
Four.
And then your stepdad, was he verbally abusing you or physically abusing you?
Both.
Was he sexually abusing you?
No.
Was he hitting you?
Yes.
And verbally tearing you down? What was his name?
Todd.
Did your mother protect you or did she let it go? She betrayed you. Your mom betrayed you and your stepdad hurt you and then the devil stole your joy.
Yeah.
Correct?
Yes.
And their names were?
Todd, Diane.
Todd and Diane. Okay, you ready?
Yes.
Close your eyes now. Raise your hands. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, you see this beautiful woman standing here? She is pretty on the outside, but inside, there's scars. Scars that were stuck into her soul by her stepdad. Stepdad and her mother. Her mother did not protect her from an abusive stepdad. She should have never married him in the first place, and we forgive her for that. That was a sin. She let a man with demons into her house and into her body and then into her child's soul. Right here. And he stole her joy. There it is. It's coming up now. There it comes. The stepdad's coming up now. Come out of there. Come out of there. Hold that. Hold that. Hold that. Come out right now. Stepdad, come out of there right now. Abusive stepdad, come out in Jesus' mighty name. Right now. Come out. Hey, how'd you do? How'd you do?
Oh, good. I'm
just...
Come out, I let my stepdad go. I forgive him, I let him go. There he is, here he comes. Did I give you one of those?
I don't think so.
That's your ticket to your new life. Right there.
I'll see you next week, brother.
Next week.
Bless you. Thank
Love you.
You.
Thanks Welcome. For coming. Stepdad, go out of that body right now. Come out. Come out of her. Terror and fear. Terror and fear. Low self-esteem, self-hatred, low self-concept. Come out right now. Come out right now. Come out of my stomach. Come out of my womb. Every ugly man that ever touched my body comes out of my womb tonight. Out of my genitals. Out of my womb. Adultery, fornication, bad man. Go now. Go now. Come out right now. Come out. Lust. Hatred of men. Anger.
Yes.
Self-pity.
Yes.
Come out right now.
All of it.
Come out right now. All of it.
All, that
all of it come out. Who else needs prayer? Anybody? Streamers, now listen. Streamers, listen to me. I'm here Tuesday and Friday nights. Wednesday night, inner healing night right here, 7 o'clock. Thursday night, the faith healers will be here. Thursday night to pray for you, 7 o'clock. Go to the website, hardcorechristianity.com, and hit the button at the top. It says post-deliverance. There's a post-deliverance button at the top. You have to go through that 12-step program so you do not lose your healing or your deliverance. 12-step program. Do not lose your healing or deliverance. Your devil will attack you within 48 hours of this service. Within 48 hours of this service, you will be attacked. He will try to steal your deliverance, your partial deliverance, your healing, your partial healing, whatever you got, he'll try to steal it. He loves to steal. He loves to kill. He loves to destroy. That's what he does. Go to the teaching button on the website. Hit the teaching button and read Satan's counterattack. Satan's counterattack. Read that article. Click the article. How Satan controls the mind. How he controls the mind. You must read that article. I'll be here Tuesday night at 7 o'clock. Teaching the deep things of God. And every Friday night for you know what. See you next time.